Yankee first baseman Luke Voit. Luke, welcome, man.
Luke.
I love it. Thank you, guys. A lot more of that this year.
Yeah.
All right, so you had just like almost like a Joe Hardy, damn Yankee sort of season. You know, you come here, not much is expected, at least from fans. They don't know Luke Voit, and you just start to rake, and you never stopped. So tell us why it's going to continue.
You know, last year was one of those opportunities. You know, I made the big leagues a couple years ago, and, you know, with the Cardinals, I was stuck behind Matt Carpenter, and, you know, I never really got a chance, and, you know, throughout my minor league career, I won a batting title, and, you know, I had great success, you know, in the minor leagues hitting, and but I just never got an opportunity, and, you know, making the big leagues is one thing, but, you know, sticking in the big leagues is another thing, and, you know, finally getting an opportunity with New York, I just couldn't get that consistent at-bats with St. Louis, and it was frustrating, and, you know, it's hard, and you ask any guy, it's a utility guy, you know, that has that role, it's, you know, tough, and, you know, for that guy that's coming in, pitch hitting in the 6th, 7th, 8th inning, and or playing every 3rd or 4th day, it's, you know, hard to get in rhythm, and, you know, every baseball player, you know, can appease to that, but, you know, I just ran with it, man. I became myself. You know, I kind of got stuck the first time I was up. I tried to show New York who Luke Voit was, and that didn't work out very well. And I think I, you know, got out of my shoes a little bit. But, you know, I just went back, stayed within myself, you know, tried to build some confidence, you know, go bat at bat instead of, you know, trying to hit a, you know, ball, you know, out of the stadium. And
it also looked, correct me if I'm wrong, that you were having a blast.
Oh, yeah. And that's the big thing, too. And that was what's great about what New York, you know, brought to me and in the clubhouse with, you know, all the guys is they brought me in. And, you know, at first, I was a little intimidated. You know, I was, you know, we got MVP, you know, Cy Young winners, All-Stars, you know, all this stuff in the clubhouse. And I was like, man, these guys have no idea who I am. And, you know, I wanted to make an impression. And I was, you know, kind of the wrong route. And but, you know, honestly, after 2 weeks, I felt like I'd been there for 8 years. Like, it was crazy how awesome that clubhouse is, and it shows the success, you know, the Yankees organization's had. And, you know, I was just like, you know what, be yourself. All these guys will accept you, whoever you are. And, you know, I kind of just did what I did in the minor leagues and, you know, had fun.
So it seems like it's an ongoing audition to just constantly prove to everybody. Is that audition continuing to this year, especially when you hear rumors they're looking for a first baseman, converting this guy to a first baseman. So does it continue in 2019?
In my opinion, no. I mean, last year I was, you know, fighting for a spot to make the team. I'm not saying I'm not doing that this year, but I actually think I have a chance to, you know, prove to the world that I can play first base and, you know, play first base for the New York Yankees. And, you know, I know Greg's going to be competing his butt off too, and, you know, I expect him to, and that's what makes this game great is that we're going to go in there competing, and, you know, I guess the best man wins.
It seems like, though, from what, you know, Boone has said and Cashman, Voit's going in as the first base. It's going to be a battle, so it seems like it's your job to lose. Do you feel that you have to put up some numbers in spring training? And that's where it's difficult for a young player. Better can just work on things, but you might have to put up some numbers.
Yeah, I mean, and I was listening to MLB Network one day, and Cal Ripken, not Junior, his brother was talking about how he never, you know, had a starting job, and he's like, yeah, I had to amp up my offseason every year because I had to show up day one, like, you know, ready to hit, you know, a 93-mile-an-hour fastball or whatever, and now it's like 99, but but yeah, I'm going to show up ready to go, and, you know, I'm ready to compete, and, you know, that's how I kind of take every offseason. I want to show up in shape. You know, I lost some weight. I want to be a better athlete. I want to, you know, be really good defensively and, you know, prove the world wrong that I can, you know, sustain this position.
And now you have some responsibility, Luke. You're not just playing for Luke and, you know, to get a nice car. You got married this offseason.
Wow. I did. And, yeah, thank
Congrats.
You.
Congrats.
Yeah, and actually my wife's, she was a 5th grade teacher and she's actually resigning next week, so that's even more pressure.
I never even told you guys this. You made me feel terrible about myself.
That's our job.
No, yeah, you guys usually. So during I've lost some weight, and I get on the life cycle. I'm doing 35 minutes and then 35 on the elliptical, and I feel really good about myself. And I go to Twitter, and I see, Luke, you're like lifting small trucks. I mean, how do you do that? I mean, do you do those workouts every day like that?
Yeah, 5 days a week. I'm trying to hit more home runs, man. I'm trying to.
Yeah, what are you trying to do, Michael?
I don't know. I want to live.
Yeah, right.
So he's trying to announce him without passing out.
There yeah.
So what is your regiment? How serious is it?
Oh, it's unbelievable.
Are you talking to me?
Yeah. Not my regiment.
I know his regiment. It's watch TV. You go like this. I've seen it 1,000 times. What do you do, though?
I got a split. I do upper-lower cardio, upper-lower, and that's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. And, I mean, it's 2.5-3 hours in the weight room. And that goes, you know, the first 2 months from October, November into December, I won't really hit. And then after that, I'll start doing more, you know, baseball activities and stuff. But, you know, before I lift, I do a bunch of speed stuff, and I'm doing... You know, I'm jumping everything. I'm trying to be, you know, the best athlete I can be and sustain it. And, you know, I think that helps a lot with me being injury-free and, you know, keep my muscles intact for, you know, 162 games. And, you know, a lot of guys in baseball don't like working out. I think a lot of the old-school guys don't like working out. But I think it's a huge part of me and, you know, keep me healthy and, you know, keep my power numbers, you know, consistent throughout the season.
Now, what's the most weight that you lift?
What kind of exercise are we talking about?
All right, it's just bench pressing.
Dumbbells are like...
The whole
Can you lift Peter arm? Over your head?
Yeah, I can lift Peter over my head.
We did? No. Let's see it. I'd like to see. Who would like to see that?
No.
All right, we need to get some money going around. Like Vegas show.
No, the reason I won't let you do it, I'll tell you right now, because one hand's going in my face, and I don't want to know where the other hand's going. That's why I'm not letting you do it.
Just close your eyes.
Now, the old days in baseball, Luke, I'm sure you've heard these stories. You know, you didn't want to get too muscular because you needed to be fluid, but you seem like you're combating that with the speed exercises as well, right?
Yeah, and I'm being more flexible, too. I mean, I'm sustaining. I'm not getting too tight to where I can't, you know, hit an inside fastball. Or, you know, I can't, you know, you guys have seen me do the splits, so I can, you know, I can do the splits at first base. But I try to maintain everything and, you know, keep my body, you know, nice and loose and, you know, fluid throughout the whole season. I mean, It's something I take my pride in, and I'll always be there, you know, every day at a certain time trying to make my body, you know, as, you know, tip-top shape as I can.
Every guy wants a team to win. Every player we've spoken to, Steve Pierce, or your teammates, you know, that's the job one is to win.
Yeah.
But do you have personal goals in your head? I want to hit X amount of home runs. I want to drive in this many runs.
Number 28. That's what I want.
28. 28 championships. That's
28
it.
Championships.
Doesn't matter how it comes.
Doesn't matter how it comes, yeah.
You know the room well, too.
Yeah, that's what they want.
Now, I look at Yankee Stadium, and then I look at you and your swing, and I say, that's kind of made for each other. When you saw Yankee Stadium, did you say,
yeah?
You
know who else that is, too, is DJ LeMahieu.
Yes, yeah.
I think that's going to be...
Yeah, he's going to have more home runs than he's ever hit.
I think so,
yeah,
too.
I agree. So, I mean, does that ballpark make you happy when you walk in? And you...
well, when you're hitting in a group with Stanton, Gary, and Judge, maybe not so much. But, you know, I try to do my best. But I've always been a middle guy, and I always try to say, you know, inside the baseball to right center, right field. And that stadium plays into my approach, which is, you know, huge for me. And, I think that kind of showed a lot last year.
How surprising is it for you as a player to still see Harper and Machado out there?
It sucks, man. I'm frustrated for them, even though I know they're probably asking for a lot of money. But, you know, at the end of the day, they deserve it after, you know, their first 6-7 years of playing and, you know, not getting paid a lot. But, I hope baseball doesn't go in the direction it's going to go in the next 2 years, and hopefully nothing bad happens. But, you know, it's kind of depressing right now. And, you know, I mean, it's not even those guys.
It's 100 other guys.
That's what I'm saying. It's not fair. And
Marwin Gonzalez doesn't have a job. He's a really good player.
He's a super utility guy. It's frustrating, and, you know, hopefully they sign. But, I mean, even me trying to get an apartment in Tampa, I, like, panic. And I know I have a job, but, like, I can't imagine them and, you know, trying to find a place and their families not knowing where they're going to go and stuff. It's frustrating. And, I mean, look what Neil Walker did. I'm sure he probably didn't want to sign in Miami, but that was probably the only offer he had.
Right. Rather than, you know, because he joined late last year, and that set him back the first half of the year. Absolutely. So, is there a solution to it? It seems like if you reach a certain age now and they don't want to give a certain length of contract.
I just hope I don't know.
That there's not a strike.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's what I probably is going to happen. It sucks.
When you look at the success you had last year and you never really had the opportunity in St. Louis because somebody was blocking you, does some of the joy of a success get taken away when you go, I could have done this before. They wasted 3 years of my career. Do you ever think like that? I could have been doing this.
I mean, that always goes through your mind. But then again, like, they gave me the opportunity to make the big leagues. They drafted me. You know, I was a senior sign.
Did you grow up a fan of the Cardinals?
From St. Louis, grew up 20 minutes from the stadium.
It seems like the perfect dream. Yeah,
and, you know, so David Fries went to my high school. I got to see him do the whole thing, you know, win the World Series MVP. And, you know, Ryan Howard went to my high school, too. And, you know, seeing those guys have a lot of success, and then David do it with the Cardinals, and, you know, he's done it, you know, with, you know, multiple other clubs, and I wanted to do that, and then I ended up getting drafted by him, and then, you know, I kind of got stuck in the minor leagues, and, you know, I kept hitting, and finally got a chance, and then I got stuck in the big leagues, and it's just like, man, when am I going to get an opportunity? And then all of a sudden, I'm getting all my family and friends asking me for tickets all the time, and I'm like, I can't get 15 tickets. I haven't seen you since seventh grade. But, you know, yeah.
You know, Paul O'Neill has always told me, Luke, that it was easier for him to play in New York than it was in his hometown of Cincinnati. Sometimes playing in your hometown is a bear. Did you find that?
Yeah. And don't get me wrong. I mean, I loved it, too, but it's hard, man. I mean, it was great because I got to go home every day, but at the end of the day, I mean, I thought New York was going to be a challenge, and it was the first couple weeks, but then, you know, it was unbelievable, and you guys took me in with open arms, and I really appreciate that, and Luke Chance are unbelievable, and I can't wait to hear him. So.
Did you root against the Rams in the Super Bowl?
Yeah.
I did.
You rooted against them.
I did.
Them.
Yeah. I can't stand Stan Kroenke. God, I guess. Yeah.
You know, I don't blame you. I mean, they left the town.
I was a diehard. Yeah. I grew up with the greatest show on turf. I had Torrey Holt, Isaac Bruce, Marshall Faulk, Kurt Warner.
The greatest.
All those guys. It was unbelievable.
And then you think you have it again. You get Todd Gurley.
Yes, Aaron Donald, Brockers, all these guys. And then, boom. See ya, L.A.
So are you? Have you picked a new football team?
No. So I went to Missouri State, and so half those people are like Kansas City people. So I tried hopping on it, but I couldn't do the Alex Smith.
Right.
That was before Mahomes started.
Yeah, right. But now Mahomes makes it easy, though.
I know, yeah, and then, of course, that. I decided not to do that, and then Mahomes.
Now, did you have family that rooted for the St. Louis Cardinals, too, and then had to go through this twice?
Yeah, my grandfather, yeah. Yep, he was a big Red fan, so.
So did you not... I mean, for the Super Bowl, were you rooting against them, or you just didn't care?
I had money on Tom Brady. How about that?
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So you were active.
You can't bet against Tom Brady.
Absolutely.
So.
No. Do you marvel at what he does? I mean, for as long as he's done it?
It's the TB12 thing, whatever that is. I mean, yeah. I think we all need
it's
to
called
to
deal with the devil.
Yeah.
I'm on TB12.
We've heard that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a Boston guy, but, you know, six rings, man. I mean, he's got... Himself, he's got as much as any other franchise. I mean, it's
amazing.
It is simply amazing. And what him and Belichick do, it's even though it's, you know, it's kind of like a like a second kissing a second cousin or something like that. Because, you know, I was a Rams fan in 2002 when they beat us and stuff. But
right,
yeah, that's
right.
Where it all started.
Yeah,
you got it kicked off.
So that's what I'm saying. Yeah, it kind of sucks. But
why don't you got Jets and Giants here? You're a New York guy now. Why don't you pick one of those?
That's what
two
I'm
teams?
Saying. I, you know,
you're up for bid.
I'm up
somebody
for
could get you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
They didn't really.
Yeah, four wins here, five wins there.
Yeah, no one really fought for you last year.
that was not a good audition.
I was more worried about my fantasy team. How about that?
How about that? Yeah.
Well, congratulations on the marriage. Are you heading down to Tampa after the dinner tonight?
I've actually been there for last week, so.
And you just flew up for this?
I heard there's a lot of video floating around of you raking already in Tampa.
I'm trying to rake. Keep raking. Keep going last year and then next year. So.
Good to see you. And congratulations
Thanks.
On the marriage.
I appreciate it, guys.
All the best.
Congrats.
Ooh, that is
Voit. Hey, thanks.